Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Home of Christ Church. Today is a very special day in that we have all of the elementary sixth graders, fifth graders that have now graduated into sixth grade joining us. So a very special welcome. If you're watching from the live stream right now and you just graduated, go ahead and just say hi. Let us know that you're watching on the live stream chat and introduce yourself. One day, hopefully soon, we'll be able to see each other and greet each other and get to know you in person. A couple of things before we continue on with our worship service. We also have notes. So if this is the first time you're watching this service, just know you could go to our church's website. The page is right there. And you could download the notes. There's outlines. You could fill in some of the questions. There are discussion questions afterwards. You could do that online. You could print it out and fill it out as you watch this live stream. And finally, we have something very special for one of our dear members and deacons, Matthew Lynn, at the end. So I just want you guys to know so that when we finish the message or the worship, don't just turn it off because there is something special for him. We will also be having a time of communion. So make sure you have your elements ready as we go into communion after the message. So let's pray and we'll continue on worshiping God together. All right. Heavenly Father, thank you so much. For this day, to allow us to be able to worship you, even though we continue to worship apart from one another, we're reminded, especially in light of communion, that your Son, Jesus Christ, is the common union that draws us together. So, Father, we pray, even though we're apart, Lord, would we know that we are part of your family, your church. And so, God, we pray that you would guard our hearts as we prepare to worship you and prepare to receive your word. Allow our hearts to be fertile soil. We pray these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, praising, glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Fill filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Savior, say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. And Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power, and thine alone can change the leper's spot the heart of stone. And Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. The throne I stand in him complete. Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Thank you. as my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forever. Sing your praise, O Lord, O Lord our God. Then on the third and break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, O Lord, O Lord our God. He shall return in robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will ride among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. No, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, O Lord, O Lord our God. Oh, praise the of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise, O Lord, O Lord our God. Oh, Lord, O Lord our God.
Well, good morning once again. Welcome to the Home of Christ worship service. Today, once again, is a very special day. We have a lot of sixth graders who will now are part of our English congregation. And so if you're watching for the very first time and you're on our church's live stream, we encourage you, go ahead and say hi. Just introduce yourself, your name, your grade, what school you're in, and one day soon, very soon, we hope to be able to see you and welcome you physically into our church family. In addition to that, our youth ministry, our youth pastor has a lot of exciting activities and programs intended for the sixth graders. But the one that I do want to highlight is there is a parent meeting for all the parents of sixth graders this afternoon at 12:30. And it's just an opportunity for you to get to know Pastor Yuji, our youth pastor, and to hear the vision and the mission purpose of our youth ministry, and hopefully help your student connect a little bit better with our youth group. Once again, this after the message today, we will be having our communion service. So hopefully by now you have already prepared your elements, so when the time comes, you can participate together virtually with all of us. Well, let me pray. We're going to continue on in our Love This Book worship, Love This Book Bible reading plan for all of you who are in sixth grade. Just know that from the beginning of this year, we started this entire Bible reading plan. So if you have a mobile device, you could go look for the YouVersion Bible app, or you could just go to Bible.com and look up this. But if you look at some of the announcements, it'll give you more directions on how to join the Bible reading plan. Let me pray, and then we will get into today's message, okay? So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. What a gracious God you are for allowing us to be able to worship you. Despite the challenges that we're facing, despite the coronavirus and all those attending difficulties, we are still grateful, Lord, for the life that you've given to us, for the breath that you've given to us, for the community, the family, but especially for your Son, Jesus Christ, who gives us eternal life. Lord, we ask right now that your Spirit would cause our hearts to be soft and tender towards you. Our ears would be open so that we may become more and more like your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. And for those of you who are joining us just now, I also just wanted to remind everyone, at the very end of this message, we have a very special message from one of our very own Deacon Matthew Lynn. So please stick around. It'll be right before the benediction. Recently, I had the opportunity to reminisce with my family a little bit of all the men and women who have gone through our youth ministry. Right now, one of my daughters is in the youth group, and soon enough, my other daughter will join her. But, you know, it just caused me to think of all the godly men and women who have come through our church. Some have made major impact with their faith. Some have gone overseas to Nepal or Thailand and Kyrgyzstan to be missionaries, both long-term, mid-term, and short-term. They're godly men and women who train up their families to know and to love the Lord. There's godly men and women who have gone into the field of medicine because they want to help and heal and serve others, who've gone into the field of finance, who've gone into the field of business or the legal profession, because they have a heart to put their faith into action. And there's many godly men and women who have already gone before. They're with our Savior Jesus Christ right now. And it is with great gratitude that I am so thankful to be able to think about these men and women, many who are serving actively across the nation, that God had given me the privilege of knowing many of them. And it also caused me to think, lest I paint too rosy a picture, there have also been some, and perhaps many, who have gone through our church and our Sunday school, our Awanas, our youth group. They've sat through countless sermons, and they've gone through countless Sunday schools, but it seems like some of those people have also walked away from their faith. Men and women who I love deeply, who for some reason or other have decided that Christianity isn't for them. And it's not just at our church, it's across the world, in fact. Men and women who have grown up in the church, but have decided that this is not the faith for them. And it caused me to wonder, why is it that some people seem to grow while others don't? Because honestly, as a pastor, if I had the chance, I'm sure if you ask any of our pastoral staff, if we had the chance and someone came to us and said, you know, if you teach this doctrine, or if you emphasize this aspect of scripture, if you visit this person this many times, then that will ensure that they will continue growing on in faith. If somebody had told me that, you bet I would have taken that advice to heart, because my heart's desire is to see men and women fall deeply in love with Jesus and continue to grow. And so the question I have for us is, why is it that it seems like two people can hear the same exact gospel message, yet end up in vastly different places spiritually? And I've heard from some of you who are about to go off to college, some of the fears that you might have. Will I still love Jesus in a year the way I love him now? Will I still love Jesus in 4 years the way I love him right now? And so today's passage, which is in Luke chapter 8, though it's also in Matthew and Mark, the passage we'll be looking at comes from Luke chapter 8. The master teacher, Jesus, addresses this very subject. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn with me to Luke chapter 8. We'll be starting in verse 4. Now, a great many people were gathered around Jesus, and he's this rising rabbinic teacher, right? His reputation has gone before him. Many people have heard of him. Many people were taking a break from work or stopping what they were doing just so that they could hear him. And they're sitting at his feet waiting for some profound teaching, some life-altering statements. In the words of Lin-Manuel, Jesus Christ, give us a verse, drop some knowledge. And so Jesus is starting to teach them. He starts to teach them with a parable. He looks out at them. He senses their needs. And nowhere does it tell us that Jesus, you know, spent a week preparing a sermon. He just knew what was on their heart, and he would use whatever was at hand. And I could imagine Jesus is looking at the crowd, and perhaps he sees out in the distance a farmer who's just throwing out his seeds. They didn't poke holes in the ground. They just scattered the seeds. And this is what he says. When a great crowd was gathering and people from town after town came to him, he said in a parable, a sower went out to sow his seed. And as he sowed, some fell along the path and was trampled underfoot, and the birds of the air devoured it. And some fell on the rock, and as it grew up, it withered away because it had no moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up with it and choked it. And some fell into good soil and grew and yielded 100-fold. As he said these things, he called out, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. It's kind of an odd sermon, wouldn't you say? By any measure, he ends the entire message with, he who has ears, let him hear. What in the world is Jesus talking about? As far as sermons go, maybe most of us would say that wasn't really a great sermon, Jesus. There's no application. There's no closing story. There's nothing that grips your heart. There's no, you know, next step, no call to repentance. Maybe Jesus doesn't know the secret to spiritual growth either. I'd imagine if I had given up a day of labor, a day of possible income, and I've taken that off to come and hear this rising rabbi or this rising teacher, and this was a lesson that he gave me, I would think I wasted my time. I mean, that's pretty obvious, right? Thanks, Captain Obvious. Any third grader could have told me this lesson. Some seeds fall on hard ground and they don't grow. Some seeds fall on good ground and they grow. And I'd imagine if I was one of those listeners, I would think, what is the fuss about with this teacher? It doesn't take a great farmer to figure these things out. Well, his disciples were also in the same camp. The disciples had given up everything. And they truly wanted to know what Jesus was saying. They, up to this point, they hadn't heard a lot about him, but they really desired to know, what exactly is this rabbi, Jesus, that we've given up everything to follow? What is he trying to say? And so they go up to Jesus and they say, Jesus, we're not exactly sure what you are saying to all those people, Would you mind giving us a little after-school tutoring, right? This is the Jewish school of tutoring here. And so they go up to Jesus, and when his disciples asked them what this parable meant, he said, to you, it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of God, but for others, they are in parables, so that seeing they may not see, and hearing they may not understand. Now, the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. The ones along the path are those who have heard. Then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts, so that they may not believe and be saved. The ones on the rock are those, when they hear the word, receive it with joy, but these have no roots. They believe it for a while, and in the time of testing, they fall away. And as for what fell along the thorns, there are those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked by the cares and riches and pleasures of life, and their fruit does not mature. As for that in the good soil, there are those who, hearing the word, hold it fast in an honest and good heart, and bear fruit with patience. It seems pretty straightforward for a world-renowned teacher to tell this story. And perhaps most of us listening or most of us reading along, you would get it. We seem to be a rather astute church. I suppose if we sat with this parable long enough, we would have made those connections. But what might bother us, perhaps, is if this is indeed such a simple statement, why wouldn't Jesus just come out and say it in a simple way? Why does Jesus have to teach in parable? Why obfuscate and obscure the meaning? Why go through all the trouble of talking about farmers and talking about seeds and soils and thorns and thistles? Because in the passage immediately following, Jesus says, no one after lighting a lamp covers it with a jar, puts it under a bed, but puts it on a stand so that those who enter may see the light. The job of a preacher is to shine the light. It's not to obscure the light or to hide the light. The job of a preacher, a rabbi, a teacher is to make the message clear. And perhaps another thing that Jesus says might stick us a little bit odd or perhaps even offend us a bit. When Jesus says, I speak to you, right? I speak to you, but to the others I speak in parables. Though seeing, they may not see. Though hearing, they may not understand. It's almost as if Jesus is saying, I don't want those people to understand. I want to confuse them. I want to perplex them. Well, what Jesus was doing is something that actually goes all the way back to Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah. And if you remember, there's this pivotal scene in Isaiah chapter 6 where Isaiah sees the Lord, God Almighty, in his throne room, high and lifted up. You remember the scene, the train of his robe, it's just filling the entire temple. And Isaiah sees God, and he's a man that is transformed. His life is altered, and he hears his voice, and the voice says, who shall I send? And Isaiah, because he is a man that is now transformed, he says, well, God, send me. Send me. I want to go. And the voice says, God says, go and say to this people, keep on hearing, but do not understand. Keep on seeing, but do not perceive. Make the heart of this people dull and their ears heavy and blind their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and turn and be healed. And what God was telling Isaiah is, you're going to go to people, you're going to preach a message of repentance. You're going to preach, you're going to give a call to have people come back to their one true creator. But what's going to happen is, they're going to hear your message and they're going to resist it. They're not going to want to do it. And the more they resist it, the more they reject the message, the harder their hearts will become. And you're going to continue to preach this clear message, and they're going to reject this message, and you're going to preach this clear message, they're going to reject the message, and they will hear but not hear, see but not understand. And Jesus says, I come like my Isaiah. with a clear message of the good news of Jesus, of the good news of the kingdom of God. But not everyone will get it. Some will outright reject it. Some look like they should get it. They act like they should get it. They dress like they should get it, but they don't. They don't want it, so they reject it. But there are others. Others will be open to it. It's the same exact message. It's the same truth. But they have different hearts. Which brings us to our first principle. The condition of your heart determines your receptivity to God's truth. The condition of your heart determines your receptivity to God's truth. Just like Isaiah before him, Jesus is clearly speaking out the good news of the kingdom of God, but he does it in a way that only those who have receptive hearts will hear. How does he do it? He does it with parables. Now, a little word about parables, because for those of us who have grown up in the church, maybe the phrase parables has kind of lost its impact, or maybe we don't really know exactly what a parable is. Sometimes we think of parables as an illustration, right? Like a parable illustrates a point. But parables are not exactly illustrations. An illustration will take a complex or maybe an obscure idea and clarify it with a picture or metaphor. An illustration doesn't actually do that. Sometimes we think of an illustration as a proverb. Like, you know, a parable, we think of a parable as a proverb, but it's not really a proverb. It's not a saying that we could just, you know, throw in a fortune cookie or saying that we could live by. A parable actually comes from two Greek words, which means literally to throw something alongside. You're throwing a message, but you're also throwing a hidden message alongside that main message. And it is up to the listener to make the connection of what that message is. The word parable is a lot like our math word, a parabola. And they actually come from the same Greek root. And so if you think of a parabola, you might think, well, yeah, there's two lines that kind of arc and they meet at a point. A parabola is a curved line that bends around a fixed point. I actually had to look this up. So all of you who forgot all your algebra, it's okay. I completely forgot this. But a parabola is defined as a curved line that bends around a fixed point without touching the fixed point. It's always equidistant from the focus and the directrix. If you don't know what that means, don't worry, you'll learn it one day. Or if you already forgot what it means, don't worry, you'll never use it again. A parable, in a very similar way, is a story around a main point without explicitly stating that point. And it's up to us as listeners to decipher what that main point is. Some of us may be familiar with the field of cryptology or ciphers, the study of codes. And simply put, a cipher, it requires a key. If you have a secret code, you need a key to decipher what that code is saying. Some of you might be familiar with the infamous Enigma machine that the Nazi Germany used during World War II. But unlike a cipher, having a key, maybe it's like every third word or every first letter of the line, the cipher is the listener. You are the cipher, and it's up to you to make those connections, to search out the meaning of what the parable is. Once again, it is a condition of our hearts that determines the receptivity to God's truth. And so how well our heart is conditioned is how much we will receive God's truth. Now, it's kind of important because later on, Jesus says, take care then how you hear, for the one who has more will be given, and from the one who has not, even what he thinks he has will be taken away. Here we come to a corollary. Not only is the condition of our hearts the key, but we have a role in how our hearts are conditioned. See here, he says, take care then how you hear, right? This is the key. To the one who has, more will be given. From the one who has not, even what he thinks he has will be taken away. And I think what Jesus here is saying is, listen carefully. Listen carefully, because if you don't use the truth you have, you will lose it. But if you hear the words of truth and you do it, more will be given to you. We condition our hearts. We cause our hearts to be more receptive to God's word when we put God's word into practice. When we hear God's word, we receive God's word, and then we do it. Or to put it another way, we either will use it or we'll lose it. And that's the message that Isaiah gives to the people, and that's the message that Jesus brings to us. We condition our hearts by hearing God's word and putting it into practice. And as we put it into practice, our hearts become more conditioned to hear God's word, to put it into practice. Some of you may have hopped onto the Victory Garden bandwagon at the beginning of the shelter in place. And if you live around me, I live in Cupertino, you'll discover quickly that most of the soil in Cupertino is actually has a high clay content, right? And so clay is good in some regards. It is able to hold on to nutrients, but it's very bad in other regards. It doesn't drain well. And so sometimes you have soggy roots or wet roots. If you ever have to work with clay, you'll know clay is very hard to work with. If you're digging up the soil, if you're trying to till your ground, you know it's very hard. In fact, I've been here too long to say a couple. Early on in my youth ministry experience here, I was tricked by a lot of the youth. And they said, "Pastor Dean, we'd like to have a sleepover at church." And they convinced me by saying, "Well, you know, we'll worship God. We'll have a night of worship. We'll have a night of prayer." But I really knew what they're up to. Really, they just wanted to play games all night long. And, you know, I'm fine with that. But being like a tiger pastor that I was, I said, "Fine, we can have a sleepover at church. But in the morning, you all have to do manual labor." So this is early 2000s. And at the time, there's a piece of grass that is now facing Bub Road that was just completely filled with weeds. And so I said, "Listen, we will have a sleepover. We will have lots of fun. We'll have lots of bad snacks. We'll play video games. We'll worship God. It'll be great. But in the morning, we're going to till the soil and we're going to plant grass. And our church is going to look beautiful that everyone who drives along Bub will see it and praise the Lord." And so we did that. We had a whole night of fun. We played Halo. We drove go-karts throughout the church. You know, it was just a great time. And I rented a big rototiller for the morning, and I bought rolls of sod that were delivered. And in the morning, I discovered my first big mistake. Never ask teens to work after an all-nighter. I mean, half the teens would not wake up. I was like pushing them. I was like, you know, shoving them, and they just wouldn't open their eyes. Second big mistake. I did not check the condition of our soil in front of the church. I didn't realize that piece of grass had rocks and roots, and it was just filled with clay. And so what we actually had to end up doing, we had multiple teams. One team would pick up all the rocks. Another team would look for all the roots and would cut the roots and try to take it out. And we had another team, and we actually needed three people to hold the rototiller. It was that heavy. One guy had to press the trigger. One guy had to hold the left side. The other guy had to hold the right side. And it was so heavy that we had to drag it with three people. It was completely unsafe. And it was really hard work that most of the teens by 11 a.m. had decided it was too hard, that they all quit. You know, in the same way, our hearts are a little bit like that clay soil. The more we resist the word of God, we might read the Bible and we think, this is good, but it's not for me. Or we hear a message and we're like, "Oh, this is really good. You know, my spouse should hear this, or my child or my parents should hear this, but it's not for me." We read something like, "God tells us to forgive others," or "God tells us to give generously, to tithe, or to be patient. God tells us to spend time with him, with his word." But we decide it's too hard. There's so many other things I can do. It's too challenging. The harder our heart gets, it's like adding rocks to our hearts. Our hearts are like this hard path that Jesus talks about. Maybe for some of us, you know, we occasionally will do what God's word says, but we're always open for something else. We say, yeah, you know, I'm gonna spend every day, I'm gonna read the Bible just a little bit. But if something else happens, if something else comes along, you know, I'm gonna choose that. Or yeah, I know God calls us to set aside one day as a day of worship. You know, but if something else comes along, whether it's a birthday or sports activity or something else, you know, I'm gonna jump on that. If there's an outing to go, work to be done, you know, worshiping or taking a Sabbath could go by the wayside. Studies have shown, in fact, the majority of Christians in America attend church only 2 to 3 times a month, right? And that's become the norm. And that's what I picture when Jesus talks about the thorns and the thistles. They're choking out the seeds with all the distractions and pleasures. There are other things that are calling for our attention, attempting to divide and capture our priorities. And quite honestly, it's so easy to be distracted. Recently, I watched a biography of the famous Dutch war heroine, Corrie ten Boom. She was trained to be a watchmaker. Her father was a watchmaker. But because of World War II, her and her family ended up hiding and rescuing dozens and dozens of Jewish refugees fleeing Nazi Germany. She ultimately was captured, imprisoned, and thrown into a concentration camp where her sister died. But she makes a statement, I think it's so true, not just in her day, but in ours. If the devil cannot make us bad, or the devil cannot tempt us to sin, he will make us busy. And I think of what Jesus said, the word of God falls on soil, but the pleasures of the world, the distractions of the world, the busyness of the world choke out the plant of God's word. And there are those who have accepted the word of God. They really have, but for some reason or another, they haven't spent any time growing deeper into God's word. They haven't been feeding themselves on God's truth. They haven't been feeding themselves on God's character. And perhaps they depend on others to do that for them. Perhaps they depend on, you know, Lunchable bite-sized nuggets that they get. And so they take on the appearance of growth, but when trials come, when tragedies come, when their faith is put to the test, there is not a deep reservoir of faith to fall back on. In fact, although this COVID pandemic is horrible in many ways, I think it's also telling for those who are in the church, not just our church, but around this nation, around the world, of those who have a deep faith, a reservoir of faith, who continue to worship God even when the norms of gathering together is broken, who continue to make disciples, who continue to study God's word. And I think it's telling. When we don't have the regular rhythms of worship, of Bible study or fellowship, are we still growing? Perhaps when our dreams are shattered or hopes are crushed, do we still believe the goodness of God? Then there are others who hear the word of God. They receive the word of God. They test the word of God. They put the word of God into action. They live it out. They might not know what to expect, but as they taste and see that God is good, their roots start growing deeper. And as Jesus says, these are the ones who bear 100 times fold what God had implanted into them. And I know men and women who have gone from our church, or even in our church, they've given up everything to follow Jesus Christ. And they say, although it looks like I've given up my career, although it looks like I've given up my future, it is all worth it because God is worth it. I know men and women who have lost everything through no fault of their own. And people look at their lives and say, what a tragedy. But they'll respond, yeah, I will still praise God, because God is worth it. And these are the men and women who has taken the word of God, have conditioned their hearts so that they're receptive to the word of God by doing the word of God. And hundreds of lives around them have been touched and have been impacted and are now growing because of their testimony. It's the condition of our heart that determines the receptivity to God's truth. And notice at the very end of this passage, we also condition our hearts by doing God's word. At the end of this passage, the disciples come up to Jesus and says, Jesus, by the way, your mom, Mary, she's standing outside. Your brothers are outside. They want to talk to you. And Jesus, he responds to them. He says, my mother and my brother are those who hear the word of God and do it. And what he's saying here, he's not denying that he has a love for his mother or his brother. What he's saying, those who are in the kingdom, those who are part of the family of Jesus Christ, those who have decided to follow God wholeheartedly, they are the ones who hear the word of God. They're the ones who put it into practice. And by doing so, their hearts are conditioned to receive more and more of God's word. So what does that mean for us today? Maybe a good self-reflection question is, what is the condition of your heart? Oops. And perhaps for some of us here, we realize that we don't have a heart for God. We've been maybe coming to church and now we're watching online, and you know, as we're just thinking about it, we have no desire for God's word. We don't make God's word a priority. We've never loved God's word. We just kind of gone through the motion. But today you sense that the Spirit of God is moving in your heart. The Spirit of God is calling you and beckoning you. In the words of the Reformer and the Puritans, God is wooing you and drawing you to him. And if that's you, I encourage you, would today be the day where you just say, Jesus, I want to follow you. I repent of my sins, of resisting you, of being my own God. I accept your forgiveness. I want to be your follower. And if that's the case, I encourage you, let someone know, write it on our chat, send an email to our prayer email address. Let us know, because it's this beautiful journey where we begin to follow Jesus Christ and our hearts become conditioned to receive more of God's word. Another self-reflective question is, how do you listen to God's word? Maybe for some of us, we realize that our hearts can use a little conditioning. Maybe for some of us, we've been going through this love, this book, and it's been revelatory and maybe even life transformational. But maybe for some of us, it's more of a checkbox. I just want to get through the day so I could say yes, and then nobody could judge me, and it has a check by my little name, you know. Maybe for some of us, we don't put ourselves in a position to really hear from God. We don't set aside a time for God. We say, I'll listen to God when I have a chance. I'll read God's word when I have a chance. You know, maybe it's right before bed. Or, you know, if I forget, I'll just, you know, cram it all together. Maybe for some of us, it means setting aside that time, reading God's word regularly, removing distractions, and preparing ourselves to listen. For some of us, even right now, it means before we come and worship God, we prepare ourselves by getting a good night's rest, by making sure that we have everything we need to hear God's word, to receive God's word. We're not distracted by being hungry or by, you know, needing to go use a restroom or whatever the distractions are. We need to hear God's word. Another question for us to consider is, when was the last time you acted upon God's word? It's not enough just to hear God's word, but we need to do God's word. So when was the last time that you acted? When was the last time you were challenged by God's word and you said, I really think I need to do this? I sense that the Spirit of God is calling me and challenging me to be transformed and conformed into the likeness of Jesus Christ. And I want to just throw this out there, because if you resist God's word, your heart is never static. Your heart becomes just a little bit rockier. Your heart becomes just a little bit harder. But if you take God's word and you receive it with honest and good faith and you put it into action, your heart becomes more and more receptive to things that God wants you to do. So when was the last time you were challenged by God's word and you did something about it? Remember, our goal for this year isn't simply to know the Bible, but to engage with it, to let God's word transform us, to do the things we read in God's word and we hear from God. Here's perhaps one of the hardest questions. In what ways are we resisting God's word? Now, I think maybe all of us in our lives as followers of Jesus Christ, there are things that we're just like, Jesus, I really don't want to do this. I really don't want to apologize to this person. I really don't want to seek forgiveness. I really don't want to comfort this person or reconcile with I really don't want to expose myself by being generous. I really don't want to share the gospel with this person. And there may be something on your heart right now that you know you are resisting God's word. And I encourage you, just write that down, right? Write that down in your notes or even just throw it on the chat. These are the things that I'm resisting. And I encourage you, find someone and tell them, say, you know, this is something that I know God wants me to do, and I haven't yet done it. Will you hold me accountable? And will you ask me in a couple days? Because I don't want my heart to be hard towards God. I want my heart to be soft. Because the condition of our heart determines the receptivity to God's word. And we condition our hearts by hearing and doing God's word. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, Lord, we want to be people who not only hear your word well, we want to be people who do your word as well. God, we confess as individuals and as church, there are times where we know what we are called to do and yet we fail to do it. There are times we know we're not living the life that you have called us to live, and we ask for forgiveness and we ask for power and we ask for your Holy Spirit to lead and guide us to do those things which are not humanly possible for us. They're only supernaturally possible. But because you have given us your Spirit to do that which we cannot do ourselves, we rejoice and we want to trust you. So help us be more and more like your Son, Jesus Christ. Help our hearts to be soft towards you, to be good soil, so that we would bear much fruit for you and your kingdom. We pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. Well, we now come to a time of communion. For those of you who are joining us for the first time and you've never heard of communion, you've never seen communion, communion is a time where we as a church family, we not only remember what Jesus Christ has done for us, but we're also reminding one another that Jesus Christ will come back for us. Communion is an opportunity for those of us who are followers of Jesus Christ, who have made a profession of faith, and through obedience, we took that first step of obedience through baptism. It's an opportunity for those of us to take this bread and this juice together, to remember the gift of forgiveness, the gift of eternal life, the gift of a transformed heart. We do this by taking the two elements, the bread and the cup, the bread and the wine, or the bread and juice. And I encourage you, if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, if you have made a profession of faith and you have been baptized, whether it's at the Home of Christ Church or at another church that also believes in the Bible, I encourage you, take the elements with me right now. I'm reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup, after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." I'm going to pray. But when I finish praying, you can continue to reflect. Perhaps there's something in your life that you need to confess. Perhaps there's an aspect of resisting God's word that you need to just allow the Holy Spirit to do work. But when you're ready, take the elements with a joyful heart. And then we will continue on with worship through offering and then more singing. Heavenly Father God, we are so grateful for how you have given us life and how you have given us hope. And we pray right now as we remember what you have done on the cross. You've forgiven our sins, but more than that, you've given us your Holy Spirit to lead us into all truth, to allow us to live the supernatural life that only you can live through us. Father God, we are grateful and we rejoice and we proclaim, Lord, that you are indeed coming back one day. Despite the challenges we face in this world today, we have hope because you have given us hope. We thank you and pray these things in your son's name. Amen.
There's a cry in my heart for your glory to fall, for your presence to fill my senses. There's a yearning again, a thirst for discipline, a hunger for things that are deeper. Could you take me beyond? What in this life could mean anymore? glory. You are the lifter of my head.
Displayed for us, oh God, we thank you for the cross. Lifted up on Calvary's hill, we cursed your name, and even still, you bore our shame. And paid the cost. Oh God, we thank you for the cross. Behold the Lamb story of redemption written on his sand. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. We sing your praise, endless hallelujah to your holy name. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. For every sin, our Savior died, the Lord of life, can't be contained. Oh God, we've risen from the grave. Oh, our God has risen from the grave. Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his hand. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. We sing your praise, endless hallelujah to your holy name. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. When the age of death is done, we'll see your face bright as the sun. We'll bow before the King of Kings. Oh God, forever we will sing. Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his hands. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his hand. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. We sing your praise, endless hallelujah to your holy name. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. You will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. Jesus reigns forevermore. The victory is yours.
Hawk 5.
Well, today is also marks a special day, bittersweet. One of our very own, Matthew Lynn, will be making the move out to the East Coast. Matthew has served faithfully as a deacon, a worship leader. He's invested into countless youth's life. He's walked with many of our young adults in this journey of faith. He's babysat countless times for many of our children. When I think of good soil, I think of Matthew. I've actually known Matthew since he was literally born, but I've really gotten to know him deeper these past several years. And I admire him so much as a man who desires to be honest and pure before God. He loves his community deeply, and I trust that God is leading him to the East Coast and to the next church that he will be a part of. And I want us to be able to really bless him Before we have a blessing together, I've asked Matthew to share a few words, which we will show now. And afterwards, when we typically receive the benediction, I'm going to ask each of you to rise with me. And even though he can't see it, we will all collectively bless Matthew together. So let's first hear from Matthew, and then we will have the benediction.
Hey, Hawk 5. This is Matthew. I'm not sure what Dean said before this, before he played this video. I don't know if he hinted at it or said it directly, but if he did say it directly, then yes, I'm leaving. If he didn't, then I would like to confirm that yes, I am leaving. I had this other video idea planned out, but time wasn't on my side this weekend, so I'm just recording this in my car. I think, you know, there's a lot of emotions running through my head, a lot of things I feel like I could say, but I just want to encapsulate it all with a really big thank you. I think, you know, I'm just really grateful that even though I've grown up at Hawk 5 and, you know, I've always seen it as home, I feel like these past 3 years, like getting to know all of you guys on a deeper level, has really expanded my idea of family and expanded just what I think a church is capable of. And, you know, I just feel like I've just been so blessed to be a part of something awesome and amazing, to be just so blessed to be a part of a family that really cares for each other. And, you know, we're all human. We still make mistakes. We still miss opportunities to care for each other. But from what I've seen, I just feel like we have so much potential and so much we can continue doing for each other. I want to thank Yaf for being my family for these past 3 years, for allowing me to be a part of a community of people who know the post-grad struggle, who know what it's like to, you know, to find a place to belong and to go through that battle. And I just appreciate you guys letting me be myself and letting me speak my mind and just be able to share what I know with you guys. And just thank you for teaching me so much about just how to love, how to be there for other people. I want to thank the youth group. You guys, I feel like, really exemplify the joy of fellowship. And I think, yeah, spending time with you guys has just shown me that, you know, church is more than just showing up somewhere once a week, but it's just really looking for opportunities to hang out more, looking for more opportunities to care for each other. I want to thank, yeah, the youth worship team for, I guess, showing me and caring for me as well. I think I've just learned a lot from you guys when it comes to loyalty and when it comes to using words and actions to really be there for each other. I feel like you guys just have an undying bond that I'm just really excited to see where it takes you guys. And I want to thank everybody else at this church. I feel like I've known all of you guys for like maybe, at least I feel like I've known of you guys for like 10, 12, 15 years. But it kind of took me leaving for college, coming back and being here for 3 years to really see you guys as friends, to see you guys as trusted companions that are praying for me, that will give me the time and the space to speak what's on my mind. And you guys, you know, you guys aren't just scary church adults anymore. You guys are, I think you guys are my friends. There's a lot I could say. Yeah, it's a bittersweet time. I think in some ways I'm like kind of glad that we're not together, because I feel like if this was happening in person, I was talking to Yaf about this the other day, and we were joking that if we were meeting in person, Dean would probably have me stand up or like come to the front and like have me say things, or he'd like put his hand on my shoulder and like just say all these embarrassing things about me, and then he'd probably have me stand in the middle and you guys would like lay hands on me or something and pray for me. And yeah, I don't know. I think COVID kind of threw everything for a loop. Just a lot of unexpected changes, and you know, the way we do church now is just so drastically different from what it was last year. But I want to encourage you guys by saying that the Spirit is still alive, that the intention and the meaning of church is still very much relevant. So continue to lean into that, continue to look out for each other, to never shy away from the opportunity to support each other. Use your words. Don't just do actions and hope people notice, but really be intentional with what you say and with what you do. One thing that I feel like I've learned from being here is that everybody's hurting. Everybody, we all have problems. We all have things that we're going through, and it's easy to just look out for ourselves, to look out for our own families, and to not extend our reach past that. But I think the church is most effective, and the church is most alive when we look out for our fellow men and women around us. So thank you to everybody. I'm going to miss you guys a lot. You never really forget where you grew up. So I hope I can come back soon. I hope that one day we can gather in person and Dean can put his hand on my shoulder or something. So yeah, really appreciate you guys. I'm going to be sad to go. But yeah, I wish you the best. Keep in touch. I'm still available. Just reach out and I'll be happy to talk. So love you guys. You guys are my family. You guys are my friends. And yeah, I'm going to miss you guys a lot. Take care. Have a good Sunday.
Well, Matthew, we love you deeply and we trust that God will be with you wherever you go. Now, I'm going to ask everyone who is watching, please rise with me as we, as a church family, send our blessings with Matthew. Matthew, receive this blessing from your church family, your brothers and sisters in Christ. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Have a great week, guys. We'll see you next week.